In this video, we quickly derive Ampere's law from the magnetic field due to a distribution of current. So this is the law that allows us to relate the magnetic field to the net enclosed current passing through a closed curve. But before we start the derivation, I think it's really important to start this out by understanding the larger context of what we're trying to accomplish here. Ampere's law for magnetic fields is the result we get when we look for an analogous method to Gauss's law for electric fields. So a quick reminder here, and I'll post a link at the top to the derivation as well. Gauss's law says that the total electric flux through a closed surface depends only on the net enclosed charge. So it turns out that taking the electric flux integral over an entire closed surface gives us Q enclosed over epsilon zero, where Q enclosed is the net enclosed charge, meaning negative charges can offset positive charges in the calculation. Now, it's important to realize that Gauss's law is only useful for computing electric field in cases with a high degree of symmetry. In particular, we need to be able to define a Gaussian surface for the flux integral, for which E is always parallel to the area increment vectors dA, which point perpendicular to the surface, and E also has to be constant in magnitude over the Gaussian surface. This renders the flux integral trivial, and we're able to factor E out and solve for it without ever directly computing the flux integral on the left-hand side. So what's the equivalent statement for magnetic fields generated by currents? It's tempting to guess that an integral for magnetic flux over a closed surface would be useful here, but remember that the net magnetic flux through any closed surface is always zero. This is sometimes called Gauss's law for magnetism, and the main point here is that the flux integral of magnetic field simply isn't useful. So just starting from scratch, what we're going to do is use the simple line current as our basic source of magnetic field. In other words, this is analogous to the enclosed point charges in Gauss's law. And we recall the result we got from the Biot-Savart law, that this magnetic field loops around the current according to a right-hand rule and has a magnitude given by mu naught I over 2 pi r, where r is the distance from the wire. And I'll post a link to where this result was first derived. Now, it's hard to see in the picture, but the right-hand rule works like this. Point the thumb of your right hand in the direction of current, and your fingers will wrap around in the direction of the looping magnetic field. Now, again, it's not a flux integral we're looking for this time. Instead, the integral whose value depends on the current here is a path integral in a loop around this wire. So let's take a new look at this wire with the current coming directly out of the page and a concentric circular path defined around the wire. According to the right-hand rule, the magnetic field swirls around this current in the counterclockwise direction. So at any particular point, it's going to be tangential to a circle surrounding the wire like this. We also label a small increment of length along the circular path, and we call that dl vector. Now we're ready to compute a path integral along this circle to see what happens. So we start with the integral of b dotted into dl. Basically, what we're saying is that we're going to add up all the b field in the direction of dl around the entire loop. And because we're integrating over a closed curve, we put a circle on the integral sign here. But this is a very special case where B always points exactly in the direction of DL. So the dot product is trivial, and we can replace that with just the magnitude of B times the magnitude of DL. Now we've done two things in the next step. First, we replaced B with the magnitude we previously computed using the Biot-Savart law, and that's mu naught I over 2 pi r. And second, we replace dl with the expression for an infinitesimal segment of arc on the circular path, and that's r times d theta, where d theta is a small increment of angle. Now the r's cancel out, leaving us with a pure theta integral, and to cover the entire circle, we integrate as theta goes from 0 to 2 pi. Note that the integral is trivial here because d theta is the only theta dependence, so when we integrate, we just get an extra factor of 2 pi. So with the two pi's canceling out, it turns out that the path integral on a circle surrounding this solitary line current at the center gives us mu naught times I. And a quick side note here, if we integrated the opposite direction as the right-hand rule, in other words, clockwise in this case, then we would have drawn our dl pointing in the opposite direction, and the dot product would have produced a minus sign in the result. In other words, currents penetrating this loop in opposite directions give opposite signs for the result of the path integral. Now, this is a really important moment because, analogous to the derivation of Gauss's law for electric fields, we just found out that our path integral only depends on how much current is contained within the closed curve. In other words, how much current is passing through the surface defined by the curve. And just like the derivation of Gauss's law, the next thing we have to do is show that the shape of the loop, or the location of the current, doesn't change this result. So now we consider a loop of some arbitrary shape with a single current passing through it. And again, we want to compute the path integral of magnetic field dotted into dl. So we've drawn a vector r to the point of interest, and we have a current pointing out of the page, so we use the right-hand rule again to get the direction of b at this point. Notice that b is perpendicular to the position vector r, since a tangential vector must be perpendicular to a radial vector. And we're going to integrate in the direction that gives us a positive result for the path integral. In other words, a positive result for the dot product at each point, which will be counterclockwise in this case. So there's our little dl vector heading in the counterclockwise direction along this path. And at the point of interest, that makes an angle of phi with respect to the magnetic field vector. So now we can start computing the path integral around this loop. And we start by looking at the infinitesimal contribution of B dotted into dl. So that's going to be the product of the two magnitudes multiplied by the cosine of the angle between them, which is phi. But now we realize that dl times the cosine of phi has a geometric interpretation. That's the length of the projection of dl onto the tangential direction, in other words, the same direction as B. And because this increment points in the tangential direction, we can use our arc length formula again and write that as r d theta for some small increment of angle d theta measured from the location of our current I. Now we can substitute our formula for the magnitude of B at a distance of r from the current, and that gives us mu naught I over 2 pi r. And we also replace the dl cosine phi with an r d theta. Now, of course, the r's are going to cancel out here, and we arrive at a nice expression for the infinitesimal contribution to the path integral, and that's mu naught I over 2 pi times d theta. All that's left to do now is sum these infinitesimal contributions with an integral. So we apply the integration to b dot dl, and now this becomes a theta integral from 0 to 2 pi in order to cover the entire path. And again, the integral is trivial, giving us a factor of 2 pi to cancel out. And there it is. We arrive at the same result, mu naught times I, even though the path isn't a circle and the current isn't passing through the plane of the curve in any particularly special location. Note that the result would have been negative mu naught times I if we integrated in the opposite direction, because our dot product would give us a minus sign at each location. So to summarize, the way the geometry worked out here is that our path integral turned out to be equivalent to a theta integral measured from the location of our current, sweeping out little d theta sectors counterclockwise as we travel the complete loop. The shape of the loop was irrelevant here because our expression for b dotted into dl simplified to only having theta dependence. Now, just like the derivation of Gauss's law, our next generalization is that we need to show what happens when there's more than one current passing through this loop. So now we imagine we have a set of n currents penetrating this loop, and our goal is to show that the path integral of magnetic field turns out basically the same. In other words, mu naught times I, but the I should be the net current through the loop with a sign convention based on the right-hand rule. So we start with our basic path integral. And the net magnetic field vector at the point of interest is a vector sum of contributions from all n of these currents. And that's why I drew it at this funky angle, with contributions coming from many currents with unknown magnitudes and varying distances from the point of interest. We have no way of knowing which way B actually points. Next, we realize the dot product is distributive, so this integral actually breaks up into n separate integrals. So we have an integral of B1 dotted into dl, B2 dotted into dl, and so on, all the way to an integral for Bn dotted into dl. But we can make the same familiar argument for each of these integrals. Each one reduces to a simple theta integral from 0 to 2 pi, and the result is mu naught I for each one. Note at this point we should put our sign convention into the results using the right-hand rule. So we can see that I1 should come with a minus sign. And that's because if you put your thumb in the direction of that current, you would get a clockwise swirling magnetic field, but we integrated counterclockwise, so we get the minus sign. Again, using the right-hand rule, the contribution from I2 is going to come with a plus sign, because when I put my thumb in the direction of I2, the magnetic field contribution swirls counterclockwise, which is the same as the direction of integration, and so on. So now we can factor the mu naught out of this expression, and we can simply write the result as mu naught times I enclosed, where it's understood that we follow a sign convention for calculating the net enclosed current. And this is Ampere's law. The path integral of B dotted into DL on a closed curve is equal to mu naught times the net enclosed current passing through the surface defined by the curve. And again, calling back to the analogy with Gauss's law, the amazing thing about this is that it allows us access to the magnetic field based only on the net current penetrating this loop, and it doesn't even matter where the currents are or what the shape of the loop is. And note that just like Gauss's law, Ampere's law is only going to be useful in cases with a high degree of symmetry. So it will be useful if we can define a curve for the path integral. And by the way, we'll call this an Amperian loop, along which the dot product is trivial and the magnitude of B is constant. If those conditions are met, then the path integral itself becomes trivial and we can quickly solve for B. Now there's a bit of an art to choosing Amperian loops wisely, and this summer I'm working on my Ampere's Law playlist to illustrate a good variety of application problems. So before we wrap things up, we actually have one loose end to cover in the derivation of Ampere's Law. So there's the essential part of the derivation that we did, but the basic question we have left to answer is why did the current have to be enclosed in the loop at all? So let's take a fresh look at this derivation, but move our current outside of the loop to see what happens. Now, everything about the setup of the integral is going to be the same here. In other words, the key point is that the integrand has only theta dependence in that d theta part. What changes is the limits of integration it takes to cover the entire loop. Again, we're sweeping out infinitesimal sectors with centers at I in this angular integral. And to cover the loop, we can locate a lowest angle and a highest angle like this. And it doesn't matter what our reference point is for theta equals zero. You could use the positive x-axis if you want, but it's not going to change the mechanics of the integral. So to cover the loop, we can integrate from theta 1 to theta 2 around the big side of this loop. But then to complete the loop, we have to continue by integrating from theta 2 to theta 1 along the small side of the loop. But both of these integrals are only theta dependent. It doesn't matter that one is on the big side of the loop and one is on the small side. So now we can just apply the properties of definite integrals to this. And when we reverse the direction of integration on that second integral, it produces a minus sign. Well, this gives us two copies of the same integral with a minus sign in between, and that's guaranteed to vanish. In other words, it really is the enclosed current that counts, and any currents passing outside the Amperian loop make a zero contribution to the Ampere's Law path integral. This video is the first in a series of videos on Ampere's Law and its applications, and the entire series is linked as a playlist at the lower left, and I'll be filling up that playlist during the summer of 2024. In the next video, we quickly compute the magnetic field due to a long line of current by using Ampere's law. That video is linked at the upper left, and I'll see you there.